I request Dr. Satya Lakshmi to please be on stage. She has around 30 years of clinical experience in naturopathy and yoga and a thorough understanding of sociology. She will be discussing with us the use of various naturopathic interventions for Swasthavritta.
I'm asked to talk about naturopathy approach for lifestyles and link it to public health with a particular reference to Swasthavritta and then Chronobiology. Yeah, this is what we are going to discuss now. And in naturopathy, of course, dealing with patients is something different on a day-to-day basis, but then we do a lot of outreach activities and sensitizing people and promoting public health in general. So how do we do it? From the naturopathy perspective, that is what I'm trying to get at. And in this, there are two ways of looking at things. One is by going close to it, and the other is taking a bird's view, contemplation method. And I'm using here the contemplation, not the concentration model. And this is so that from Ayush, we should, I think, revisit our community medicine and then understand it from that perspective. Then we become relevant in public health. So far, we are very, very individual specific, and we treat people only when they come to our doorsteps. Supposing if we don't talk about things that are largely affecting public people, and then we become irrelevant there. So what are these issues? So we usually, in our public interactions, we ask people to ask these questions, five questions. The first question is, do I have good appetite? The second question is, do I get proper sleep? Then do I have satisfactory bowel movement? Do I enjoy my day's work? Am I cool and composed while dealing with others? Now these are five questions. If you give any non-affirmative answer, that means there is it has something to do with your lifestyle. You don't have to run to hospitals or go to doctors or even diagnostic centers to evaluate yourself, but you, with little minor corrections here and there, maybe you can set things right. So how are these small things have a big link to this public health? Let's see each one. Do I have good appetite? So how is my appetite has a link to public health and then food? Usually we ask people how much they're eating, whether they have good appetite, and how many times they're eating, what they're eating, whether they're any allergic to foods, and then how many times they eat out, and what kind of junk food they eat. But then this, we all know how much to eat, what to eat, when to eat. It is very clearly defined in all of our systems, and then we are very fairly thorough with that. But then suppose we go further one step back and then try understand where this food is coming from. How is it grown? How is it manufactured? How is it packed? How is it stored? How is it prepared? And what kind of food are we eating? Are we nurtured only by food? Or are we also nurtured by air, sunlight, moonlight? And if all these things are helping us to get sufficient nutrition, are we getting it? If we are not getting it, what are the conditions that are prevailing or preventing us to get these things? And do we have a role to play there? Are we doing that assessment? It's called health impact assessment. Are we doing or made any steps in the direction where we can also look into, say, for example, now in Punjab is one of the first states to adopt green revolution, right? And highest rate of cancers in the country now. If there is any link, then if we can establish and then understand it, and then see, because Now, next is Andhra Pradesh is the second, highest cancer incidence. And it is the second state to adopt green revolution, next only to Punjab. Is there a pattern? And do we have to look into that also? Because day in and day out, we do a great deal of counseling on food. But then we don't talk anything about these chemical residues and what kind of chemical residues are considered persistent organic pollutants, how are they considered as EDRs, endocrinal disruptors, how endocrines are getting affected, and blah, blah, blah. You know, these are anyway there in public domain, but then we have to link it up to our understanding and then advise people properly on those aspects. And just trying to bring it to your notice. Now, polluted air in Delhi. Now, governments are telling people not to come out of the houses. Are we living in Fukushima, Japan, where there was a nuclear meltdown? No. But then why the situation has come to that state? It's just because of burning of hay. Yeah. So if that has any link to public health, then how can that be prevented? And if that there is an answer in changing people's food consumption patterns, I think we should offer that. Then vitamin D deficiency. When we are sun surplus country, in fact excess, why people should have vitamin D deficiency? Because most of the time we are living indoors. So which is the right time that one should expose themselves to sunlight and moonlight, and how to breathe, how to eat, and when to expose? These are some of the things of our concern. I think we should stretch our imagination in those areas. Then the second question, do I get good sleep or proper sleep? And this is a big question now. Now, why I brought these things for discussion today is now we are living in a world of energy dense environments. Energy in every sense. Now, in a room, if you're sleeping, the entire room is wired. And then you have lights, you have TV, you have mobile next to you. There is electromagnetic as well as non-ionizing radiation permeating all through and through you. And then if this is disturbing our sleep patterns, if our sleep patterns are affected, we are sure we all are facing every day, and we are seeing patients with sleep disturbances and then problems. And then particularly girls who are not going to sleep early and then not able to get up early, you know, are all ending up with PCOS. And there is a straight link. And then if this link, if it can be established, if it can be seen and then taken up seriously, I think we become more relevant in public health. Then the question of, do I have satisfactory bowel movement? This should also be our concern. Yes, one American medical journalist asked me this question, why Indians are becoming more and more using Western commodes? Is it a question? It's so, and then she has got a, nichingnow.com. In that she posts this post, podcast. In that podcast, she was interviewing people and then putting it. In that, the question is precisely this, why people are going for Western commodes in India, which was not there 40 years back at all in India. Now there are only one airport I've seen, they've put a board, Ahmedabad, they've put a board, Indian commode. All others are now by default Western commodes. And then this is for urban and then affluent people. But what about rural people? Now our governments are bent upon introducing toilets in the houses of people. And then they're saying, if you want to preserve the dignity of women, have toilets. That is the bait. The dignity of women is the bait for having a toilet. But I am saying now the burden on a woman has increased, wherein water is a big issue, and now she has to carry more water for the entire family to meet the needs of water intensive technologies that are used in constructing toilets. Now, is it doing good to her or bad to her? Is one question. The another question is, the toilets that are constructed with septic tanks have a gas pipe, you know, which has to be closed. But most of the time it is not closed. Hence, it is becoming a breeding ground for vectors. For multiplication of mosquitoes, it is becoming a point. So, should we not talk about these things and then ask for technologies which are actually suitable to our populations? And dry latrines are there. And then in Netherlands, and people are using sawdust so that water is thoroughly absorbed and then no smell and then no water is used there. You know, if they are trying, and where they have everything at their disposal, in spite of that, they are thinking about, you know, certain technologies which are less water intensive. Now, bowel movement, we shouldn't be just limit ourselves to this individual, whether he or she is having everyday motion or not. Otherwise, where any assistance is needed, these are the questions may be needed, but then we should also be talking about more than that. Then, do I enjoy my day's work? This is another big issue that is building in or bringing in stress into the lives, wherein I don't do a job out of my interest. I do the job because that is what is available. So the stress there, and it is showing on my work, and then it is showing on my health, it is showing on. So not only just occupational hazards that are anyway there, that also we should be looking at. Now software people, they have the list of health problems that they are facing now. At a very, very early age, 25 to 30, they're with 4 or 5 complaints now. Which is not an age to talk about health complaints, but then they are with, because of the occupation. Then do we have solutions? Can we not understand that with this profession these are the issues that they may face, so prepare them for that? And I think that these are the areas we should seriously look into. Then the last question is, am I cool and composed while dealing with others or even with anybody around? We see so much of violence around, road rages, and in offices fights, and then at homes there are no compatibility whatsoever. All this is happening because there is no communication which is less violent. We are not training people into non-violent communication methods. You know, there are many techniques, simple techniques, how to get rid of the stress, how to unlearn certain practices so that we are more comfortable even if people differ. Now, we don't want people to differ. What I say, they should just listen and accept it and implement it. Any little bit of discrepancy here and there, you get into rage. You know, this is. And particularly with young children, school children, it's happening. They're killing each other and hitting each other. And Delhi also we have seen, and Mumbai we have seen. And it's happening everywhere. I think we have to be very, very sensitive to all these issues. And then, because they're all linked to Swasthavritta, they're all linked to chronobiology, they're all linked to our day life cycles. And there is no way we can escape these things. And if we are really want to be relevant in the area of public health, we have to develop algorithms, we have to develop or sensitize ourselves to these issues. Not only these 5 questions, we can bring in more questions like this, but these are common questions we have been asking all along from my final year onwards. Whenever we were going out, we would go with these 5 questions and ask them and then write and then come back and then talk to ourselves. So, but even now we are doing it, but some of the questions are really bothering us. I think we have to take stock there. Thank you so much, and I'm sure you are bombarded from morning on chronobiology, so I'm not going details into the real cycles of day and night, we can, some other time we can have it here or even at NIN. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.